And I wanted to just talk about this passage. We're in a series in which we're talking about sharing our faith. And we share our faith because that's what God has taught us to do. What God has wanted us to learn and what God wants us to be connected to is how we share our faith. One of the ways we talk about that in our church is for those who are lost from God, those who are looking for God, those who need a connection to God, and just need to be reconnected with God as a whole. When we talk about it, we use it in these sort of concepts or these sort of ideas or this passageway for us to know and see it for them. And so we're going to use this story that was read in Scripture today from Luke 15 about the shepherd who sought and who went to look for the one sheep that was lost. And so it's a really, really interesting story. Now, what's fascinating for me is how God comes about working with us. See, what he did was, as he came into this place, he did so in a way that drew people near to him. He began to use this story that was really odd and unique. It wasn't so much odd, it was very straight on to the culture of what they were doing. And not only was it straight on to the culture of what they were doing, but it also guided them to trials and tribulations. So they had this story that Jesus was able to give them from Luke 15. So what I wanted to think of, and what I wanted to know, what I wanted to understand, is that God is calling us to go into the place. Now, some of you might have used your bulletin last week to write down some names of people that you're praying for that would come to church, or that you would invite the church to come to the event. I'd like you to take out your bulletin right now, okay, and fold that over. And you might, I know you're going to take lots of notes on the message here in just a second, okay, but you might want to have some room right now. And you might want to write down the names of those people that you said that you're going to pray for this week. Or maybe that you would be having the chance to invite them to church or invite them to come. Write down the name, and I want you to commit to praying for them. And right now, this is, maybe you have the chance to write this down, and this is not even embarrassing that I want to do this. I just want you to hold up your hand and say, yeah, I prayed for those folks this week, I made an invitation. And write this hold up your hand and say, okay, thank you. Fantastic. Awesome job. Awesome job. So we're going to be asking you next week to get ready for it, okay? So be sure to write that down. And see if you can get that as a goal. And so I wanted to be kind of keeping those minds, those names, those people there before. You know, for me, I've had them on my daily prayers, and I found Rodney's bulletin at the house while I was cleaning up the kitchen, moving things around, and I started getting the field written down there. This is the place we want to go because God wants us to be on this vision. See, God pursues us. People matter to God. He's all about bringing people to Him. And if you were the only person on earth, Jesus would still die for you. You are a precious creation of Jesus. So God, in His pursuit for us, God wants you to be in a relationship. Romans 5, 8, Christ tells us, while we're yet sinners, Jesus died for us. And since He's reached you and me, possibly, maybe you're sitting here today, He's not yet reached you, maybe you haven't yet stepped across the line of faith. But as I said last week, if you already stepped across the line of faith, and if we're already in church today, we ourselves are a place that we become hosts of the party. If we become hosts of the party, we're those who want to begin to make responses to what God is doing. And so let's make sure we do that. God, thanks so much for coming here. I ask that you would just help us to hear your voice. Lord, take this time and make it yours and not mine. Lord, take this thing and make it yours and not mine, but also take this thing and leave it. Lord, if we're coming today, there are lots of different thoughts in our minds. Things that we have to do, places we have to be, things that we're going to do, things that take place. God, I pray that this be a holy, sacred space for me. It's all in the dedication of you. But now, by the power of the Holy Spirit, all we get all we feel like. We don't have that to come to you. But we have to sometimes come to you. So God, by the power of the Holy Spirit, be present with each person to you. Let these concerns and worries migrate to your minds. Prepare the hearts and souls for the action of the Holy Spirit. And speak to them again. Thank you. Jesus hears the story. Jesus hears the story in which he's talking with the scribes and the Pharisees. So you look at Luke 16:1, it tells us in Luke 16:1, it says, now all the tax collectors and sinners were coming here to listen to him. And then verse 2, and the Pharisees and the scribes were grumbling, or as in the NIV says, muttering, and saying, this guy welcomes sinners and sinners. Why were they so upset? Well, they were so upset because the Pharisees and the scribes were kind of like the storytellers of the day. What do I mean by that? The storytellers of the day were those who began to say, how does our culture view us? How does our culture view things? How do we understand how we're going to respond to different things? These were kind of the power brokers of that day. They were telling the story of how we should think about things. So what would it be like today? Today would be like those who run CNN, those who run maybe Fox News, or those who run movies and tell stories in the culture that makes the culture ways that we see what's happening and know what's going on. So they're beginning to tell this story. But Jesus, though, he comes in and he relates to tax collectors and sinners, which makes the Pharisees and the scribes not very happy. And so he begins to relate to these people who are tax collectors and sinners and those who are causing problems. And the Pharisees and tax collectors, or the Pharisees said, well, it's not right. You shouldn't be doing it. They're muttering, they're grumbling, they don't like it. How dare you meet these folks who are tax collectors and sinners? Why was that such a big issue? Well, how many of us like to pay our taxes? Okay? All right? Okay, thank you so much, Bruce Miller. You're one of those guys for a living, so yeah, thank you so much for giving me that witness. Put your hand down. Okay, at any rate, so we don't have the right to pay our taxes, but that's up to the notch. That's up to the notch, okay? Even though we don't like to pay our taxes, we still get some great benefits from it when you stop and think about it. I mean, if you have a fire at your house, praise God that we live in Carroll County where we have fantastic volunteer firemen and firewomen who come out and will help you with your house. How many of you, when you go to your house, and I know if you live in the country, this may not apply to you, but if you live in the city, and you turn off your faucet, and you have to come down. Anybody like that at all? Okay? Yeah, okay. Isn't that a great benefit of some of the things that we pay? Well, how many of us, if we have a problem and we need a policeman to come, the policeman is there in a moment's notice? Okay? We praise God and thank God for some of those things that happen. But let's stop and think about the people of Jesus' day. When they're paying their taxes, they were not necessarily paying them to folks there in Israel, they're paying them to Rome. They're paying them to Caesar. Not only they're paying them to Caesar, but these were people who were not Jews, they were Gentiles. Okay? And so you're giving your tax money to a group of people that you didn't want to begin with. You couldn't stand them at all. And these are the people that Jesus is attracting. He's attracting that everyone in the culture is going, I don't like this. I can't believe they're coming to church. Can you believe they're here at church? They don't belong to be in church. They shouldn't be there. I can't believe it. They were grumbling, they were muttering, they were just upset with what was going on. And so then, what happened after that is that there were also the sinners. Now, the sinners were kind of like those who would just show up when they needed to show up to get the forgiveness they needed to do these customary laws, and they really wouldn't worry about the rest of the year. They really didn't care whether or not they followed all the Jewish laws correctly. They were those who just really were kind of out there. So the Pharisees and scribes didn't like them at all either. So these sinners who were just out there living life of abandonment, and these tax collectors are the ones Jesus was connected to and the ones he taught and prayed. And the scribes and Pharisees, they didn't like the fact. They were upset about it. Not only were they upset, but they wanted to do something about it. So that's the setting here. Now, what I like about this story is that Jesus sees these folks who are upset, and they say, this fellow welcomes sinners, and he's supposed to be with them. So Jesus then sits back and says, I'm going to tell a story.
And all of Luke 15 is about telling about something that was lost. So if you look at Luke 15 going through, there's all these different stories about finding something that was lost and then things that happened there. Okay? So what are some things that people have said that they lost? I want to kind of show you. We had 11 folks texted in the first service and had various things they lost. One says here they lost their voice, their mind, and their glasses. Okay? Another person lost their daughter's $400 brand new orthotic. Okay. Yeah. Some people say, I lost my mind and I'm still looking for it. I think I have some kind of disease. Okay? Yeah. Someone lost their Stanley Cup trophy. I don't know what that was about. Okay? Someone lost their son's passport. Okay? Some folks lost their watches. They're still looking for their cell phone. Another person lost their kids. Okay? In fact, at the first service, Jamie Smith told me she lost Bill Smith at the in the Grand Canyon when he was 2 years old. So, but she found him, obviously, because Bill Smith is still with us. Another guy told me that he lost his marriage dad twice. He would always be looking in the shop where he was looking on vehicles and stuff like that and take it off because of that, and he'd always tell him something for the vehicle. The way he just bought a cheap marriage dad, and guess what? He never lost his stuff. So much for that. Sometimes we lose things, and we go searching for them. We're longing to find them. We want to find where they're going. Sometimes I lose my glasses. You know where I usually find them? On top of my head. Okay? You know, sometimes I lose my keys. You know where I find them? In my pocket. Okay? And sometimes I lose my cell phone as well. We lose that. We lose things, and sometimes we have to go and search and find them. Okay? But God searches and finds for us as well. What's happening in very strong and very good ways. And that's where this story comes in. Jesus, after hearing the scribes and Pharisees get all upset and mutter and gripe, says, I want to tell you a story. Now, Jesus is smart. He always told these stories in his parables. And there are those who heard it and those who listened to it and wanted to make sure they heard it in the right way. So, go on to tell the story in verse 3 of chapter 15. It says this. So he told them this parable. Which one of you, having 100 sheep and losing one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after one that's lost until he finds it? Now, why did he tell that story? He told that story for a couple of reasons. One reason he told there was because he knew the answer already. He knew that even the scribes and Pharisees, based upon what was in the law, and based upon what they were thinking in their minds and hearts, and based upon the culture that had an agrarian sort of a concern with animals and so on and so forth, and having sheep, would automatically answer yes. We would go and look for that one sheep, because he knew that's exactly what would happen. And so he sets them up kind of with this question. Okay, which one of you, upon losing one sheep, isn't going to go and look for the one? No, in the hearts and minds as they're listening to him, they're going to say, yeah, we would be out looking for the one. We would also be going and looking for that. In verse 5, he says this, when he has found it, he lays on his shoulders and rejoices. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, rejoice with me, for I found my sheep that was lost. Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. So Jesus lays out this statement. I want to kind of think of which ones we are in this story. Who are we in the midst of this? See, the shepherd looks out there and sees the sheep and says that there's one missing. See, the shepherd says, I'm going to go and look for that one. That's God's call. That's God's desire. God's desire is always ready to go and look for the one who's wanted. And I want to take a sheep, okay? In case you've ever looked at sheep before, they are not the brightest animals in the stable, okay? Sheep are usually the most, well, challenged animals in the stable. Sheep will wander off easily. They'll usually wander off and wonder where they're going. In fact, sheep, once they wander off in the fold, are susceptible to so many different things. They're susceptible to wolves, to animals, to different things that can take them, and they can be taken out in just a moment's notice. And so when the one wanders off, it's susceptible to so many dangerous things. And so all those sheep aren't very intelligent at all. They're also even worse off when they're off by themselves. Sheep also tend to follow goats And those will easily wander off, and they can kind of defend themselves a little bit better, believe it or not. And they can get around to different places that quicker than sheep. And they're able to be taken care of their civility, but they'll easily wander off and follow another crowd, another group, and they'll go another direction very easily. And so that's the situation that Jesus is dealing with his story. He says, here is this one sheep that wanders off. But what's the response of the shepherd? The response of the shepherd is to go and find, to go and look, to desire to want to go after them, to find that one sheep. But what's the response of an unknown? Well, Jesus doesn't really tell us the response of an unknown in the story. But he just says that when he talks about the passage of the scribes and Pharisees, were grumbling and muttering. I can't believe he's off there looking for that one sheep. Can you believe that? If that sheep wouldn't have gone off and wandered off, he'd be fine. Can't believe that sheep there. You know what? That sheep just deserves it. Don't worry about that. That's the way they are. The grumbling, the muttering, the anger, the way of responding to it is kind of a tough one. And we have to look at it sometimes and say, how do we in the church respond? Are we the 99 or are we the one? And you know, I might even look and say, where am I today? I might be the one. I might be the one who has wandered off. I might be the one who has lost and wondered, will the shepherd come for me? I don't know what to do, but the shepherd does come for you, and the shepherd loves you, and the shepherd cares for you. In fact, if you look at this story, what it tells us is that the shepherd goes out and finds the sheep, he pauses and he finds the sheep, does he fold the sheep? Oh, you bad little lamb. How dare you get off here? Why did you leave that? You just stay off there. I'm going to let you stay. Here comes the wolf. Here, wolfy wolf, and get the sheep. Okay? Does the shepherd do that? No. He doesn't say, let's have lambs off. Okay? That's not what the shepherd does. You want it off, we're going to eat you. Thank you so much. Boom. Keep going. Okay? No. What does the tell of the story is that the shepherd does? The shepherd goes and picks up the lamb. Why does he pick up the lamb and carry it? He also picks the lamb and puts it over his shoulders and carries it over his shoulders. Okay? That's a place of protection and care in the midst of his story. Not only the protection and care, but the shepherd's even carrying a staff. Why did the shepherd carry the staff? The shepherd carries the staff sometimes to pull sheep back in the line, but also to protect them as they were out there in the wild and around different dangers. So if the shepherd has a sheep over his shoulders and carries, he can still hold his staff and use it. Imagine carrying a lamb like this when you use your staff. You take the lamb, you put it over your shoulder, it's in good protection, but you still have your staff. And if the wolf that comes near, you can swipe out with the lamb. If you have clear brush to get through something, you can use that staff to clear brush to get through something. If you're one, there is one with it. I want you to know today, you matter to God. You matter to the shepherd. You matter to the one who goes and looks for them. You matter to the one who will leave the 99 to come and look for them. You matter to God, and God wants to come after you, and he wants to scoop you up, and he wants to put you on his shoulders, and you don't have to walk back, because you probably already walked so far that there's no way you can even begin to walk back. But you can be carried by the one who loves you and cares for you. But sometimes, we're not the one who wants. Sometimes, we're the one who's leading the fold. Sometimes, we're one of the 99. And maybe we've been one of the 99 and we've been here for 20 years, or 30 years, or 40 years, or 50 years. You know? And we fixed 20,000 subscribers. Okay? We counted out 1.5 million bulletins. Okay? We have helped at every father daughter dance since it ever happened. And sometimes we're in those positions because we're human. We sit back there and we say, if they just come back on their own, they'll be fine. Somebody said that was enough. Why does the shepherd care about that one more than us? I mean, hey, we're the ones who help pay the bills. We pay the pastor's salary. We take care of the life. We pay for the debt. Why don't they care more about me than they do about all these folks out there who are far from God? And if we're honest, we stop and think about it. Sometimes we respond keeping the mind. Sometimes they're keeping the mind. And we have to stop and say, what's God's business to God? God's business is about the one who's wandered. The 99 who are in the fold, they're already protected, they're already taken care of, they're already being loved. But what God wants to also do with the 99 is He also wants to equip the 99 to be a part of bringing about the one back. And so we see in this story that when the one comes back, not only does He find the land, not only does He place it upon His shoulders and rejoice when He comes back, when He comes home, He calls together His friends and His neighbors, saying to them, rejoice with me, party with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost, just so I find you. And He's saying this to the scribes and Pharisees, just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over the one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who don't need it. And the 99 righteous persons are the ones He wants to use to go out and seek and search for the lost. That's God's plan. That's why our vision is what it is. That's why we want to try these different things. This 99 who goes and this, it changes everything. One thing we're going to do is that we're probably going to stop, we're going to kind of change our worship schedule just here. We want to make sure that we coach you and equip you to know what to do. One of the things we want to talk about is that as you're here in church, you welcome those who are around you before church begins. We also want to spend time welcoming folks after church begins. After church begins, I'm sorry. Do you realize there's two times that are most important to a brand new person? That's a matter of a testimony told me just last month from one person who walked in this place and within 10 seconds received a hug from somebody who had never met that person in their entire life and said, I am glad to see you, welcome to them. And they received a hug. And they stood there and they looked and they said, my entire life is different because of that hug. Now, you want to know the time that is more difficult for newcomers in the church, not just when you first walk in, it's the 5 to 10 minutes after the worship. And most of you go, say what? What's talking about? Here's what happens. Say, for example, there's someone that you don't know who's here to you. It's sitting there. And you're not aware of who it is. But you're like, most people think about that someone who's here to you, but you have no clue from doing it. Okay? You know what it's like? I mean, am I talking to the choir? Everyone's like, I've got no clue. Yeah. See, there's an amen over there. Thank you so much. Now you go, I have no clue if they're still here. And I don't even know if I want to embarrass myself by saying, how do I have a show for you to do that? And you kind of worry about that. But after worship service, what we find was secret worshipers in force that we got that out of and I live at hundreds of trips all across the state of Indiana. The most important time is the church service. Why? Two things. First of all, some people come, pretty good music, like it. Sermon was not bad, okay? So, it wasn't too bad. The class is slightly ugly, but yeah, it was not bad, okay? No amens, I heard that. Okay. But they're feeling pretty good about it. But you know what happens at the church? We got to get the lunch. We got to get the games. We got to catch someone else about the children's program that we're doing next week with them. And boom, the church gets up, boom, we spread. Or we got to have a conversation with someone else because we really want to catch up with them and see what's going on. And it's someone that we know. And people who are brand new, all of a sudden, boom, everything goes away from them. And they kind of go, So here's what I want coaches on. After the worship service, if it's someone that you don't know, you just kind of, have I had the chance to meet you yet because I don't remember the name? Would you help me out? Okay? And they go, oh yeah, I'm Jack Jones. I've been coming here since Moses was birthed, okay? And you say, fantastic, I'm glad to hear that. Good, I've been coming here since Jesus was dirt, which is a little bit less time. And all these sorts of things that get connected to. But if you begin to make that connection after worship service, it helps for one. The one who might come again said, I need help. I hope I can make it. And one who came in and had a hug and saw their life completely changed. The one who needs the hug just needs another one to get into the door. he can read the metal wing to stop looking at it. And so, it's so funny, and how it took so long, I messed up too, and God took the key up, and let me go. Because this is just a really fun life to keep it. Amen? But our God was messed up people. Our God took that messed up people. He picks up the wing, cradles the wing, he brushes it off. Because for everything that's been around the wing, that would have tried to find it. He might even have to put a bandage on it. He picks up the wing. It's not going to happen. It's not going anywhere. It's got its stuff. It makes its way back home. It makes its way back home. He puts the hand down his throat. But God is the way he wants to be in the first place. Here's my question. As you've written down those names, will you be part of the 99 who says, we're not going to go on to the right, and I'm going to the left? We'll pray, we'll speak, we'll hug, we'll care for, we'll take the risk of having conversations with someone that we don't know, even if we might embarrass ourselves, and say, I'm going to sit back with God. Because the one who took the shepherd, the great shepherd, took you up one time. He put you on his shoulders, and then he walked with you. My husband told me, to do that on this